I just came by to stir your soul up a bit. Put on your seatbelt. Get ready. This ride could have some turbulence.
I'm Tabetha McNeal, and this is The Next Up, A Creator's Journey to Success. And today's special guest, we have Noémie. This amazing, amazing, and super talented queen. If you haven't seen her photography, you're at a loss, seriously. I saw her stuff, and I was just like, this is like Barry Gordy. This is like Spike Lee. It's like I'm watching a movie with no sound. With nothing. I could just watch her pictures and be like, yeah, I feel all the emotions of everything. So, Naomi, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Where do I start? So, I am Congolese. My family's from the Democratic Republic of Congo. I was born in Belgium, moved to Atlanta when I was really young. So, I was raised in Atlanta. Grew up watching films. And I'm the youngest of three, so I would watch whatever my siblings watched, which typically was not of age appropriate for me, but it did, you know, create this like curiosity of like different storylines and just the world. And so then middle school, I was really drawn to independent films just because they were much more raw. And at the time I was just like going through a lot of like typical teenager shit, but I didn't know how to fully express myself. So I was like, well, let me just try visuals. And as much as I wanted to do video, I did photography just because it was easier and more accessible. So started off at 14, taking photos. Self-portraiture was like my starting point, and I guess also a signature of mine now. And then fast forward to college, I took photos everywhere, just of friends. And then I had a side hustle and took graduation photos. And so that was like my first introduction of like taking this side hustle and making it a job. And then fast forward to 2017, I moved to New York. I knew I needed to be in New York for multiple reasons. I just really sensed it in my spirit. And since then, everything aligned. I decided to go full-time in photography in 2018, self-employed. And it's been awesome ever since. So
yeah,
that has been my journey. I'm now in a space where I want to do half photography, half filmmaking, just so I can bring that passion of mine from childhood.
No, that is awesome. And speaking of your photography, y'all, if you haven't booked her with her studio, do it. Before Rona happened, I was literally about to come over here. I was thinking of like doing it for my birthday. And I was like, I really want her to take my pictures for my birthday. And then, you know, all of this.
I know. It's tough.
Yeah. So my first question is, can we talk about your amazing short film, Blue Sands? How did that all start and what made you do it?
So a lot of my like short, I call them digital doodles. So it's essentially like, I think of a sketch in video form and I'm usually inspired by audio or music. And so I was at a coffee shop listening to my SoundCloud playlist, and the song came up, and I'm like, whoa, this is a dope song. And I just had this visual of a beach. I knew I wanted to include Black men, so I reached out to two of my friends. And yeah, it was also at a time where I was like, I want to start collaborating with people because I'm just so used to working with myself, and it's much more fun and interesting to work with a team. So that was my first video shoot where I had a second cameraman, I had a stylist, I had an assistant, I had a BTS photographer, I had like, you know, and so yeah, there really wasn't a storyline to it. It was strictly off of this song and the song that's playing in the background. And even when I was shooting it, I had my headphones in so I can listen and just that's what was guiding me. But yeah, that's, I love Blue Sand so much.
No, it is an amazing, I loved it because I think the same way you do, like I'm listening to music and I can visually see everything. I thought I was crazy, cool, okay. Like I literally can see you just like putting on the headphones and being like, okay, this goes here, this goes here, this is what I wanna see, that is beautiful. So again, with more of your photography and especially with all the Black excellence you have, you know, taken pictures of, Cicely Tyson, Bisha Webb, Crystal Fox, and Felicia Rashad on A Fall from Grace. How was that?
That was insane. I found out about that shoot 3 days before.
Mm-hmm.
And I found out who I was photographing, I think, the day before.
Ooh.
And so I was just kind of like, I mean, Felicia Rashad specifically, you know, I grew up watching The Cosby Show. Like,
yeah.
My brother and sister learned English by watching The Cosby Show and, like, other shows. And, like, so it's just, all I saw was Claire Huxtable. but, yeah, it was awesome. Like, there was a moment, because it was also an interview, and so someone was interviewing them. And Cicely Tyson was just like, there was a moment where, oh, the interviewer, and this was before the interview, the interviewer referred to the group of them as you guys, which all of us do, like, naturally.
Yeah.
Miss Tyson was just like, wait, am I a guy? Is she a guy? Is she? And so much in the most respectful, like grand auntie way,
yeah,
just like read us to remember how we like call ourselves. Like, we are ladies, we are women, we're Black women. There's no you guys in this.
Yeah.
It's like so amazing. And then there was another part where in the interview where she talks about her mom, you know, standing in line, trying to find a job, and everyone's crying. And in that moment, I'm like, I kind of want to like videotape this, but I also want to honor, you know, their story. And like, mm-hmm. No one really gave me a green light. And after the fact, they were like, oh man, we should have recorded that. I'm like, oh, I thought about it. But either way, like that was a very surreal experience. And I was just kind of in shock that I was in that room, you know, like, yeah. I don't, when I got into photography, I never saw it as like, oh, I'm going to take photos or videos of people that I've been watching and look up to. I was really just like in this art focused realm, mm-hmm. and also God led realm, you know? So that was just insane. I thought it was going to kind of pivot or like start off the direction of the rest of the year, because I shot that in January and that was my first shoot of 2020, but we took a different turn. But yeah.
No, I mean, you really hit the ground running, okay? Like, you got to meet all of them in one place. Like, I would have passed out from Cicely Tyson. And then yeah. I would have been like, can you somebody help me get up off the floor to meet Felicia? Like, lost my mind. So amazing. And if you haven't seen her shots, you guys, it's on her Instagram. They're beautiful. I mean, she shoots in a way that tells a story. So I love that. Another thing that I wanted to ask, with Pryor Moss, sis,
yeah.
Uh-huh. I've never seen so many Black people be that Black in a long time. I was like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Wow. How was that?
The first time or the second time?
I want to know both.
The first time, that was, I was speechless. I'm still speechless to this day. Mm-hmm. That was the first shoot I did officially, like, as a self-employed photographer.
Yeah.
I didn't know much of Pryor Moss prior to that, but a friend of mine opened for him for one of his previous shows, and so all I saw was Black people, and I saw fashion, and that's what I loved.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, like, shooting backstage, and I was there like in the beginning because my primary role was capturing the production company who produced the event, founded by a Black woman, Brittany Escovedo. And so I was mostly focused on her team and like them setting up the benches and setting up the makeup and like setting just like all this setup and showing how much work it takes to bring up a fashion show.
Yeah.
You have this like Black owned company, production company, and then all these like dope ass melanin fly models just walk in looking like wearing the most casual clothes but also looking incredibly dope.
Yes.
What, like you have different shades, different hair types, short 4C, 3A, and they're just like, and I'm just looking at them and I'm like, wait, what? It's just, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that was awesome. The choir was amazing. Just
looking, I lost my mind on that choir. I said, wait a minute. I know we can sing, but that, woo, took me out. Yes.
So it was beautiful to hear them. For the second show last year, the same thing. It's like just really jam-packed. And I mean, for the last year's show at Sister, it's called Sister, at the Lincoln, it's not the Lincoln Center. I forgot what it's called. King's Theater. There you go. It's at King's Theater in Flatbush. That was open to the public, which was really dope. And seeing people file in and like seeing everyone just hype and like the theater is just blackety black. It was amazing.
Yeah.
It was amazing.
Speaking of another amazing moment, you also took pictures of Janelle Monáe.
Yeah.
How? How? Tell us.
So, that one, I was actually still working at, because when I moved to New York, I was a brand designer at a startup. So I was actually still working at the startup, but it was very flexible on the time that we worked.
Mm-hmm.
So I was able to leave early, but a friend of mine from college, she actually works with Wonderland Records. And so she hit me up. She's like, hey, you know, we're going to be in town for Janelle Monáe's concert. Like, are you interested? I'm like, absolutely. And so, yeah, I got to photograph Saint Beauty, and it was actually for Saint Beauty. It wasn't for Janelle Monáe.
Okay.
And so created like a video promo for them, but I also got to stick around for the concert. That was the first concert I've seen of Janelle Monáe, and I actually listened to Arch Android my entire freshman year in college. Like,
wow.
Soundtrack. And so, like, again, I never take those moments for granted. I'm always present when it happens. It's never like a whatever thing to me. It's always just surreal. So that's just another surreal moment.
Wow, that's awesome. That is so cool. So I also want to talk about, you are a fashion icon. Seriously. You put things together that are so amazing. And again, it just like, the way you wear your clothes tells a story. So when did you get into fashion?
I think what inspired what I am today fashion-wise is like middle school, because the school I went to was like 50% Black, 50% white. But the majority of classes, I was like the only Black girl in it. And so the majority of my friends were white. And in that time, it's like Hollister, American Eagle, like Birkenstocks.
Yes.
I wore clothes to fit in. And then transitioning to high school, I was trying to just keep up with what everyone was wearing, but it didn't feel like it was me.
Yeah.
I vividly remember junior year, right before junior year of high school, I just made this decision to like figure out my style. And I remember going to Charlotte Russe and getting this like high-waisted pencil denim skirt And I'm like, you know what? I like this. This is dope.
Yeah.
We need that. And then I started, you know, Tumblr was popping at the time. And so I would always just like seek out different photos. And then, yeah, like I even had a goal to be best dressed in high school. Second place. And who I lost to still doesn't make any sense to this day. But yeah, I mean, my parents are always about clothes as well from a quality standpoint. Mm-hmm. And just like seeing old pictures of them, like they just look super fly. And so I believe what you wear, you know, is a great way to express yourself. I love fashion. So I'm really grateful and touched that that's how you see my stuff. Because I am very specific and intentional on everything that I wear. So
no, yeah, yeah. I mean, again, in her pictures, you tell a story. I'm just like, what's going on? I need to know where this comes from. So I also want to talk about you being at the advanced screening of Dolomite Is My Name, and you took pictures there. How was that? I mean, seeing the movie for the first time, how was that for you?
I never watched a blaxploitation film.
Same.
I've heard of it, but I didn't think much of it. And so... yeah, like the movie was awesome. It wasn't what I was expecting at all. Like I really loved the storyline. I loved, you know, Eddie Murphy's character. His name has lost me. But yeah, it was just like a super cool perspective on how building the community through the arts is essential, you know?
Yeah.
And I am really like moved by and want to be led by is making art tangible and something that, you know, makes people feel better or forget about what's going on. And so, yeah, that was a super dope experience.
Awesome. What are some movies that you are inspired by when you're doing your photography?
Doing my photography. I mean, Queen and Slim.
For sure, yeah.
If Beale Street Could Talk.
Yes. Ooh, The Child. Okay, that's my favorite. The Child.
Waves.
Yeah.
I love Waves just because it speaks on like the gray area of life and like there are certain subcontexts that we don't consider or ignore when it comes to the big picture. And I incorporate that approach to my work where it's like it's more interesting to see, you know, a notable figure like in their most candid state rather than like being posed on the red carpet.
Yeah,
like, just continuing that humanity storyline. I recently watched Mother of George, which was stunning. And I loved its depiction of African people. Like, even though it's centered around Nigerian culture, like, I still saw, you know, my aunties and my mom and my family and just that community. So that movie is definitely grinding my gears or, like, shifting my gears on my approach to my culture and my African culture. So definitely that, but... honestly, anything that involves Black people. Oh, and Insecure. Insecure. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, that is so awesome. I think in a lot of people's work, some of those same movies that you were talking about come up because they do show the Black experience. They do show Blackness in a way that is different from what we usually see, especially if Beale Street Could Talk. I mean, that is such a revolutionary story. If you know nothing about James Baldwin, like, you crazy. So, yeah, one of my favorite movies is actually Moonlight. And I was just like,
Yeah, that too. Yeah.
It's like all these colors. I just want to live in that every single day. So, for sure. My next question is, you know, where do you kind of see yourself in 5 years? Hopefully Rona's gone. We're safe.
I have no idea. I mean, with all that's happened in this year, I'm very detached to my plans now.
Yeah.
And I'm just like focused on being led with my purpose. But hopefully, like, I'm shooting my first feature film. That would be amazing. Maybe in a different country, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe married, I don't know. I don't know, but happy.
Yeah.
That's enough. Yeah.
So this is our last question. What is some words of wisdom that you live by to this day that helps you get through, you know, your purpose?
Kind of drawing a blank, which is crazy because I write all the time.
No, you're good.
I mean, the thing that just keeps coming to me in this time especially is, like, home is within myself. Because, yeah, so many things can happen, and you feel off course, and you feel lost, and you feel like you are behind, or, you know, you're off track, but your home is within you. So, like, you can't, it's impossible to, like, steer away from that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I'm like, I'm really big on just relying on security and love within myself to keep me moving forward. Because I used to weigh that heavily on external things, whether it's my job, whether it's what my social life looks like, whether it's how I am financially. So yeah, just like keeping that reminder that it's already inside of me. And so I can't lose what's already within me, essentially.
That's beautiful. It's not Sunday. The whole word. I forgot about one of my favorite questions that I love to ask people. This one may stump you. So if you could cast anyone in your feature film, who would it be and why? You had the budget. You had all the money in the world. You could get anyone. Who would it be?
Kelvin Harrison.
Okay.
He's an amazing actor. He was in Waves. He was in The Photograph as Lakeith Stanfield's friend.
Mm-hmm.
Only one person or just?
Choose five.
Oh, okay.
Choose five. It doesn't matter.
So him, Shia LaBeouf.
Yes.
Right.
Can we talk about Shia LaBeouf for a second?
I have the time for that.
Look. I saw Honey Boy, and I was like, this man isn't, I already knew that he was great, but Honey Boy was just one of those, how do you play your dad?
Yeah.
You know, how do you play a parent that has hurt you? How do you do that and be very chill and just really take on that? And then at the end, it's like, I forgive you.
Mm-hmm.
Lost it.
I mean, he's actually my childhood crush. And there's a home video of me talking about him, so that's proof I saw him first. But yeah, Honey Boy was beautiful. Mm-hmm. And you can tell the amount of inner work he had to do personally to get to that space. And that I admired most about him and just that movie, because even with me, like, a lot of my work involves a lot of vulnerability. And I'm super mindful of making sure I don't exploit my experiences and make sure that whatever I'm open or willing to share, that I'm in a good place with it first.
Yeah.
Because when you intertwine that personal side with art or your professional life, like, it can get messy in a way, and you can kind of like get lost in validation or just kind of feel confused or overexposed. So watching Honey Boy was just like, that is like, you played your dad who yes. affected your life in like, who intertwined your professional life and the life that we all saw but weren't aware of the other side, like the layers of that, the work of that, the time of that, the energy of that is so inspiring. So
yeah,
and he's fine as hell, so I mean,
sure is. Also Peanut Butter Falcon.
Yes, I watched that 2 weeks ago, and I watched American Honey this yes. past weekend.
Yeah,
I'm like trying to watch everything that he's in right now.
No, it is so beautiful. Peanut Butter Falcon had me in tears. So did Honey Boy, but Peanut Butter Falcon just really took me out. I said, okay.
Yeah.
I don't like this side of you. Okay. Go. Because, you know, we saw him, you know, do Transformers, and I was like, okay, cool, that's cute. But, you know, when he started venturing out and doing his own stuff, I was like, you're an actor. Like, I hope he knows that. He probably does. But I'm like, you could do anything. When you start playing real people, to an extent of where like I'm okay with it, mm-hmm. and it's not overexposing like you were talking about, that's it, that's the work. Yeah. Truly, that is. So yeah, he's an amazing actor. So who else?
Mahershala Ali.
Yes, he can adopt me, please.
I'm just like wondering if he has cousins, you know, that are seeking
marriage,
you know.
Because
I remember him in House of Cards.
Yeah, so
seeing him in House of Cards, seeing him in Moonlight, and then what was it called, The Green Book?
Mm-hmm.
Watched that with my family in December. So yeah, he's also a very versatile actor. Clearly, this is going to be an all-male cast, which is fine.
No, it's
Rami Malek from Mr. Robot. I'm just, like, curious to see what else he can do. I haven't seen the movie where he plays Freddie Mercury, but Mr. Robot, it's, like, that's also an amazing show, but I'm curious to see his like drama side, you know, like his romantic comedy side, you know.
Yes,
that is four. Okay, who's my last one? I'll include a woman in this one.
Okay.
Ryan Destiny.
Wow. Okay.
Just like, she's also, it's like a curiosity thing where I'm just like, I see something, I don't know what it is, but I see something, mm-hmm. and I would love to work with that. So yeah, very random group, but
it's whatever. So I love it. I can't wait to see it now. I think it's gonna be awesome. So thank you so much for being on the show today again, you guys. If you haven't seen her work, you are crazy. You are insane. I mean, I truly believe that, like, whenever she comes out with her feature film, like, we're just going to be in tears. Just slain. Just out and just in the aisles, already on the floor, because as soon as the music hits, I'm going to be weeping.
I receive that. I receive that heavy emotion. Thank you.
Because I just feel like when I'm watching your things, I'm watching a movie, I'm watching a film, mm-hmm. I'm watching life happen with nothing going on inside. Mm-hmm. I'm watching people live their lives in such a way where it's freedom. Mm-hmm. I mean, you take pictures of people being free and happy and, in, you know, just over the overall just Black experience. And I think we need a lot of that. So again, thank you so much for being on the show today.
Thank you.
You're a joy. I can't wait to see what's next for you. I can't wait to see what's next for you. I can't wait to see, you know, what fashion things you are, what you're going to do. I will definitely be coming to your studio when Rona's over, okay? We'll send all my coins straight to you. So thank you so much for being on the show. I'm Tabitha McNeal. This is, say your name again, because now it's gone. It was so much in my head right now. I'm like, oh my God, I got to ask her so many questions. But yeah,
Noémie,
thank you so much again for being on the show. You are awesome. We're definitely going to have to, you know, keep in touch, talk mm-hmm. about movies. We could talk about Shia LaBeouf for 3 hours. I have so many things.
Absolutely.
So again, thank you so much. I'm Tabitha McNeil, and this is The Next Up, and I will see you guys on the next episode. Bye.
Bye.